Hello and welcome to today's Partner Web Conference. This is Fast Track Dynamics 365 for Finance and Operations Enterprise Edition Tech Talk. Today's topic, Enhancements to Warehouse Processes in Production. Presenting for us today from Microsoft, we have Senior Program Manager Johan Hoffman, and on Q&A, we have Engineer Ivan Markovic. So without any further delay, Johan, over to you.
Thank you very much, and thank you for joining this Fast Track session. My name is Johan Hoffman. On the agenda today, we have four enhancements that we made for warehouse processes for production. All these four enhancements are available for the Dynamics 365 for Finance and Operations spring release. The first topic we are going to cover is material replenishment using the withdrawal Kanban. Next one is a new flushing principle for automatic material consumption in production and batch orders. Then we have a new handheld workflow for issuing raw materials with the handheld device. And the last enhancements we are going to talk about is how we can configure the default production output location on the resource level instead of only on the resource group level. So let's get started. We'll start with the first topic, material replenishment using the withdrawal Kanban. So looking at this slide, we have an example of using the withdrawal Kanban to replenish raw material on the production floor. So we have a production warehouse where we have a process activity where we are replenishing raw materials with the help of a withdrawal Kanban. Material is stored on a material warehouse where we have locations, and these are not fixed locations. So the withdrawal Kanban, or you pick the raw material on the material warehouse from warehouse locations there, and you pick with the help of warehouse work. That warehouse work is brought to a from location on the material warehouse. And then with the help of the withdrawal Kanban, you can transfer the material from the material warehouse to the production input location on the production warehouse. The withdrawal Kanban has been there since we introduced the lean manufacturing. But what is new here is the ability to create warehouse work on the material warehouse, as you can see here. And you can use the withdrawal Kanban not only for lean activities, but you can also use the withdrawal Kanban for production and batch orders. So let's take a closer look at how we can use the withdrawal Kanban. So I'm now going to switch to the application. And I'm going to open the Kanban board for transfer jobs. In this in this Kanban board for transfer jobs, we see all the withdrawal Kanban that transfer materials to the from one warehouse to the other. So I put a filter on this, so I only look at specific Kanbans. In the list here, you see the withdrawal Kanbans. Some of them are already completed. One of them, the last one here, is open. And if we take a closer look at this Kanban, it's tasked to move 10 pieces of the material, and it's going to transfer it from warehouse 51 from the transfer from location, that is 001, and then to warehouse 61 and the location 009 that represents the production input location. Looking at this Kanban, it also has a picking list. So the transfer board has a picking list section, and you can see the material availability on the transfer from location. And what we can see here is that this Kanban is going to transfer this raw material, M9207, in the quantity of 10 pieces, and it has a status of work created. So going back to the slide, the Kanban here is created, and work has been created to transfer the material from the warehouse locations to the to location or to the from location. So we cannot make the transfer yet because work has not been completed. So let's try to complete the work. So I'll go back to the application. So one thing to mention here is what we did for the spring release is to enable work creation for the withdrawal Kanban. So work has to be set up like for other processes, and we used an existing what we call work order type, and that is for Kanban picking. So if we look at, for example, the location directives, I set up the location directive for Kanban picking. So this work was generated based on the location directives and work templates for Kanban picking. This location directive is also used for the other type of Kanban, which is called the manufacturing Kanban. You have two type of Kanban, the withdrawal Kanban and manufacturing Kanban. They are sharing and using the same location directive and work templates. Of course, you if you have different processes for the manufacturing Kanban and the transfer Kanban, you can set up the location directive to distinguish between these two types. So you can edit, for example, the query on the location directive, and then you can set up a criteria for either the process or transfer type. In this example, I didn't set up any criteria, so we will have the same pick process for both types of Kanban. Just for those of you who are not familiar with the Kanbans, the way to create a withdrawal Kanban or the prerequisite for creating a withdrawal Kanban is what we call a production flow. So I created a production flow. I named it Transport to Warehouse 61. Taking a closer look at this production flow, we can visualize it. The production flow defines the activities for a Kanban. It's very simple for a withdrawal Kanban. It only has one activity defined. It's a transfer activity. And we can see here that it transfers from warehouse 51 from the location 001 to warehouse 61 to the input location. So it's pretty simple. So you define the production flow, and then when you have done that, you create what's called a Kanban rule, which sets the policies for Kanban created. For this rule, so we have a rule here, 41, and if we look at this, we can see that this is of type withdrawal, the other type is the manufacturing Kanban, and I refer to the production flow that I just created with the first activity here, transfer. I also associated the product to this Kanban rule, and the Kanban rule also you also specify the quantity, the default quantity, in this case is 10 pieces that you move each time with this Kanban. And you also have something called a fixed Kanban quantity. So in this flow, you always have two Kanbans in the flow in order to meet the demand on the production flow. So once the Kanban rule is created, you can create the Kanbans, and they are created here. So let's get back to the Kanban transfer board. And now I'm going to complete this work that has been created. I can see the work details from the Kanban transfer board from the work details menu. So here is the open work. So I'm going to copy the work ID, and then I'm going to my handheld device. In this case, I'm using the new handheld device, of the new app, and that can be installed from the store. So going to the menu, I'll go back, and then I'm going to log off the app. I just want to be sure that I'm logged into the right warehouse. It's warehouse 51, and then I'm selecting the production menu, and then we have a menu item called the Kanban picking, and I scan the work ID, target license plate. And then I complete the put to my 00, there was a setting here that I missed. Because what I did now was actually, I'm completing the put now. So now I actually completed the put directly to warehouse 61, and I also completed the Kanban. So that was a setting I didn't explain on right now, but if I go back to the Kanban rule, and look at the definition of my transfer activity. I set this activity up to automatic complete the Kanban. But what actually happened here was that if we look at the figure here, I completed the work from the handheld device, and the withdrawal Kanban was automatically completed in the flow and transferred it directly to the warehouse 61. So in this scenario, the warehouse worker, it's the same warehouse worker that picks from the warehouse location on 51 and brings it directly to the production input location on 61. If I do not set up the Kanban to complete automatically, then I have to complete the Kanban in the Kanban board. So it represents two different processes that you can support, either completing silently the withdrawal Kanban when you complete the put of the work and then it's brought directly to the input location, or the warehouse worker working on the material warehouse will bring it to the from location, and then we have a separate activity or process, probably done by another worker, completing the withdrawal Kanban. So now the Kanban I just created is on the production floor. Once this Kanban, these 10 pieces that I brought to the input location has been consumed, then we have a handheld activity for completing or marking this Kanban as empty. And with this empty scan, we create a new Kanban for the flow to make a new replenishment on the flow. So if I go back to the Kanban board, here I have my Kanban, and it's now in state completed, and it's transferred to this location. This Kanban has a okay. Seems like that we lost the audio. Can you hear me again? Okay. Sorry about that. So what I'm going to do now, we lost audio, so I'll just wrap up here. I'm going to make what we call an empty scan on the production floor, saying this Kanban is now empty. Please create a new Kanban to replenish. So I'm locking off the handheld device, and I'm logging in as a user who works on warehouse 61. And when I go to production menu, I have the empty scan option here. And then I'm going to scan the Kanban card. It's this one. And now it says work completed. And what happened here is it created a new Kanban, waiting for transferring the items from 01 to 009. So that wrapped up the session of new warehouse processes for the withdrawal Kanban that you can use for replenished material on the production floor. In this example, I defined the process or the production flow for transferring between two different warehouses. So those customers who use separate warehouses for raw materials and for production, they can use the withdrawal Kanban to seamlessly transfer materials across warehouses. Those of you who are familiar with the warehouse processes knows that, for example, warehouse work only works within one separate warehouse. But here you can transfer between warehouses. You can also define the withdrawal Kanban to only transfer between activities on the same warehouse. And I also showed you two ways to set up the flow for the withdrawal Kanban. One is to, when the Kanban is created, work is created to transfer from the warehouse locations on the material warehouse to a from location. And then we have a separate process to complete the withdrawal Kanban in the Kanban board for transfer jobs. Or we can set up this transfer activity to automatically complete when you complete the put transaction for the peak work, and then the worker is directed directly to the input location on warehouse 61. So, moving to the next topic. So, what I'm going to talk about here is a new flushing principle for automatic material consumption. So, we made a little example of that. So we have a production process here, and we have a production input location for this process. When we release a material for this process, a production process, warehouse work is generated from the warehouse locations. And when we complete this work, material is then transferred from the warehouse locations to the production input location. After that, we need to consume this material on the input location. And we do that by the use of the production picking list journal. We have different flushing principles. We can flush the materials on the input location when we start the production process. We can do it, that is by using the flushing principle start. We can also do it by when we finish the process using the flushing principle finish. We could also do it as a manual process, and then we do that traditionally by opening a production picking list journal and then just account for what we consumed. So a new option we introduced is a flushing principle called available at location. What this does is when the warehouse work is completed, the put transaction is completed, then the material is automatically consumed for the production process. So that means it's automatically brought into WIP. And this feedback has come from many customers who regard materials, when material is on the production floor, then it's regarded as part of WIP. So they, instead of accounting for it manually, then it's just automatically brought into WIP when work is completed. There's a different scenario. So what about if the material is already on the input location? In that case, when you start the production order, it's the production, the material is consumed by the picking list journal, like the start flushing principle. So let me show you an example of that. So I'm going to switch. Can you still hear me?
Sound great.
Okay, yeah. Okay, so let me show you an example of how to use the new flushing principle. So I have a production order here. prepared, 260. It is in status released. And if we look at the bomb, we have two raw materials here, M9203 and M9204. So let's look at the first bomb line. This bomb line has a flushing principle called available at location. So that is the new flushing principle. And there's elaborated field help here where you can read more about this. If we look at the other one, it's called a manual. So this has been set up to manual consumption. So before processing the work, I'll start the production order. I'll start it according to the flushing principle. It's going to look at the flushing principle. You can see, you already know now that I didn't complete the work, so I don't have the material available on the production input location. So it will not flush when I start it. So I'm going to start the production order. So the root card journal was created, but no peaking list has been created yet. It's empty. And then there is a question already here. I could answer that. One of the participants is asking, so how picking this can be posted automatically if the production order has not been started? So it cannot. So the production picking list can only be created if the production order is in status started. If I process the work when the production order is in status released, I can complete the work, but the picking list is not created. When I then start the production order, then this material will be consumed by the production order. So I go to the work details here, and then let's try to process the first work here. And I again go back to my handheld device. And I'll go to production pick, scan the work ID, and I'm in the wrong warehouse. In the last demo, I ended up in warehouse 61, so I'm going to change to 51 again. I'm going to log off the device. 51. And production pick. So I get license plate. So now I'm going to put it to the production input location and confirm that work has been completed. And I can also see that from my work header here, work is now closed. Sorry. Yep. Can you still hear me?
You sound great.
Okay, thank you. So going back to the production order now, after work has been completed, I'm going to look at the picking list. And you can see a picking list has been created and it has also been posted. If I had opened the picking list a little faster, then I will see that the picking list was actually not posted. And that is because when the picking list is created by the completion of the work, then the picking list is created and the posting of the picking list is put in a batch job. So we kind of separated the process of creating the picking list and posting the picking list to a batch job. It has several reasons. One is a performance consideration. It could also be that if you had data on the picking list that was not valid, for example, a wrong financial dimension, something that prevents the picking list from being posted, then it should not affect the completion of work. So let's say that you have a picking list that cannot be posted due to, for example, a wrong dimension, then you can complete the work to the input location. And then when the batch job tries to post the picking list, there will be an error that you can take care of as a backend operation. So that completed the demonstration of this new flushing principle. So in essence, this flushing principle integrates the process of creating and posting the picking list when material becomes available on the production input location, whether if it's already available when you release the production order on the input location, or when it becomes available when you complete the put transaction of work for raw material picking. So are there any questions on this topic? Yeah. So the next one I'm going to move to is a new handheld flow for issuing raw materials with the handheld device. So as I showed you now, we use the new flushing principle to consume material. So we did that with this material or available at location flushing principle. We can also set it up to auto consume by start or finish, or we can have a manual consumption of material using the production picking list journal. You often use the production picking list journal when you have, for example, variation in consumption. We have many customers who weigh off materials before issuing it to the production. And there might be a variation on the weight or on the flow meter. You might also want to be very sure that you account for the correct batches that you actually consume. And you cannot do that as a backflushing, or you don't rely on an automatic backflushing operation. So you'll have to account for that in the journal. Be sure that you consume the right in the right amount and with the right batch numbers. So far that has been supported by the picking list journal. So user would have to go to the picking list journal. It could be created when you started the production order, but not posted. But many customers have asked for a handheld option here. So people on the shop floor using the handheld device for completing work for raw material picking can now also use the handheld device for account for the amount of material consumed for a production order. So I'm going to show you an example of how to use this new handheld workflow. And so before doing that, there's one question here. So there's a question here. Do you mean the picking list? So this is referring to the new flushing principle. Do you mean that the picking list will be posted via the batch job as soon as the production order is started? Do I need to set up this batch job separately? So the thing is, if you complete the work when the production order is that was released, then when you complete the work, no picking list will be generated because the production order is not in the right status. Then when you start the production order, it will recognize that this job, that the work has already been completed for a material with this new flushing principle, and then it will create the picking list journal and put the posting to batch. You don't need to set up the batch job separately. It's just using the batch service, and it will be posted within a couple of minutes. So going back to the example with the new workflow for issuing raw materials, I'll now move to the production order we looked at before, this one. So I already consumed the first material, but we still have work pending for the second material, M9204, and it has a flushing principle called manual. So with that, I indicated that this material is going to be consumed as a manual action. So let's complete this work so it's on the input location. So I'll go back to my handheld device and the work ID. Little bit slow. Then I enter the target license plate. And then finally, the put transaction to the input location, and then I'm going to confirm it. And work has been completed. So the material is now on the input location 002. It has not been consumed yet. So I'm using now the handheld flow for registering consumption of this material. So I go back to my handheld device, and I created a menu item called raw material issue. I can show you afterwards how to define this new handheld menu item. So I just select that. It asked me for what is the production or batch order from which I want to consume material. This is the production order number. And then it asks me from which location do you want to consume from. In this case, I want to consume from the input location, from where material was, to where material was transferred by work. But I could actually select any location on the warehouse. I can also select a license plate. Then it will consume from a specific license plate I point out. So far, we are only able to consume materials that is part of the production bill of material. And we're also able to consume more than what is specified. So we are actually also able to overconsume. So in this case, I want to consume from zeros, the location 002. Then it asked me for the product 9204. So this is the product I want. If it was a batch enabled item, it will ask me for a batch number to consume. And then it asked me what is the quantity. So I can use again this, or I can use board here, so 18 pieces, and then I'm going to confirm unit inches, and okay. And what you can see is a journal line has now been created. So if I go back to the production order and look at the picking list, a new picking list has been created. So the flow has created this picking list. It has not yet been posted. So this flow is now waiting for more interest, so I could pick other materials and they will be part of the same picking list. If I cancel out of the flow, the picking list will still be open. And if I log in again, the same user and on the same production order, and start making new registrations, then they will select the open picking list and add lines to that. So I can keep on adding to this picking list. Once I have completed what I want to consume for the order, I have a done option. And when doing that, the journal is then posted. So this was an example of using the new flow for material consumption. So this is often used in when you use the flushing principle manual, where you don't want to automatic flush materials, but account for the amount of material you consume for the production order, but also for example, the batch or serial numbers that you select to consume for the production order in order to keep traceability. So any questions on this topic before we move to the next one? That is not the case. So then I'll move to the last topic in this session. So it's the default production output location on resource level. I made a little drawing here. We have three stamping machine 10, 20, and 30. They all have an output location. So things coming out of this process is on the output location, and put away work can be generated from this output location. Before this enhancement, we were only able to define the production output location on the resource group level. So the warehouse worker could only pick up from one location from a group of machines belonging to the same resource group. In case these machines are physically on very different locations, then it can be difficult for the warehouse worker to know exactly what belongs to which process. So now we refine this a little bit so we can define the output location on the resource level instead of only on the resource group level. That is easy to show. So let's go back to the application, and I'm going to use the same production order here. This 260. This production order has two operations. One is called assembly and curing. And the principle for finding the output location is that it's going to look at the resource or resource group used by the last operation, because that is where the finished good is reported from. So looking at the last operation here, we have the resource requirements. This is connected to a resource called 5111. So if I go to the main table for this resource, on the resource group tab, I have the relation between the resource group and the resource. And we added the output warehouse and the output location in this grid that was not there before. So now I have out one. And that means that when reporting is finished this production order, it will use this location. We still have the output location on the resource group, but let's try to I go to report as finish, and it selects automatically out one at the output location because that was what was defined on the resource level. If I go back on the route, and look at the resource again, I can, for example, remove the output location on the resource level and then see if I have a resource location or an output location on the resource group. I have. That is a different one. So let's see what happens if we confirm the extension. Now you can see the location then changed to use it because there was nothing on the resource level, then it looks at the resource group level. And if there's nothing on the resource group level, it will use the default output location on the warehouse that we are reporting to. So that completed the last topic I had. So there is one question here. Please kindly repeat how you posted So this is, okay, so there's a question to this flow, issue raw materials with the handheld device. How did we post the journal? I'm going to show you how that is done. I'm going back to this production order. And if we look at the picking list, the picking list was generated by the flow, the handheld flow. I consumed 18, so there's still two pieces remaining on the input location. So let's try to use the handheld flow to post the last two raw materials. So what I do, I go to my handheld device. Raw material issue is already the flow that I'm in. I'm scanning in my production order number. Then I'm going to specify the location from which I'm going to consume, 002. It's a little issue here. I have to scan it two times, but that is going to be fixed. So this is the material I'm going to consume. And then I can take the remaining two pieces and confirm that. And then it's called out in the bottom, journal line is created. That indicates that a picking list has been created. Journal line for this item added to the journal, but the journal has not yet been posted. If I scan more items here, then those items will be added to this open picking list journal. Once I have completed my picking and I want to bring it into WIP, I use the done option. I select the done option on the flow, and then journal is posted. Yes, other questions? And those could be questions to all the flows. That does not seem to be the case. Then I will say thank you very much for participating. I hope you enjoyed the session and found it useful. We have, before leaving the session, I just want to point you to these two links, the roadmap on the Dynamics roadmap. You can find information about the features that are in development and are planned for the fall release. And there's actually a few that is under development, so it might be interesting for you also within this area. And you can also get a description of what has already been released. If you have ideas for coming releases, then go to the ideas portal where you can look at already entered entries, and then you can vote on these entries if you think those are good ideas that you want to see in the standard product. And if you don't find them there, you can create your own entry. What is important is if you don't you don't need to kind of specify the solution to a problem. We rather want to see what is the business problem and a very good scenario, and then of course we will think about the solution. And then we have the question here from Kim Anderson, just before we leave. It's around the new flushing principle, overpicking in the new flushing principle. How is that possible? So with the new flushing principle, we are doing what we call order picking. So what do you actually, so work is generated, for example, for 20 pieces, and then you pick 20 pieces, and it will create the picking list journal with the use of this flushing principle for 20 pieces. We also have, we can also pick from license plate controlled locations. And when you do that, you have like a principle whether you want to do staging and or order picking from this location. If you choose staging, the principle is that you move the quantity of the license plate to the shop floor or the production location. Well, let's say you have 1,000 pieces on the license plate, and the production line wants 100 pieces. Then you stage the pallet, and once you complete the put, then you the system will automatically generate a picking list for 100 pieces and leave 900 remaining on the input location. Once you create a new production order for the same finished good, it will recognize that there's 900 on the input location. Once you release that order, and with this blocking principle, it will generate the picking list automatically when you release the order, because it's already available on the input location. Did that answer your question? That seems to be the case. Thank you for that. So, as there are no further questions, we want to thank you for this session. Thank you very much.
All right. Thank you, Johan. All right, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to take a moment and bring your attention to a link that I posted in the messages panel. That's a link to a short survey for this web conference. We ask that you please take a moment before logging out to access it. We hope that you found today's information helpful, and if you enjoyed today's web conference or have feedback on how we can provide you with a better event, this is your chance to let us know. The survey scores are on a scale from 1 to 5, with 5 being the highest score possible. And that is going to conclude today's web conference. Attendees may access the web conference recording via the same registration link used to attend today's live broadcast. I'd like to extend a big thank you to our presenters, Johan and Ivan, and thank you, audience, for logging in and joining us today.